Greetings and welcome to Marah Talks History. Today I'll be talking about the first emperor of the Heraclian dynasty, a man who inherited a corrupted and weak empire, who nursed it back to its full strength, who pushed back the Sasanian attack, recovered lost territory, just to lose it again in the end. That man was Emperor Heraclius I of the Eastern Roman Empire. Heraclius was born in 575 AD in Cappadocia, Byzantium, which is located in modern-day Turkey. He was the eldest son of Heraclius the Elder and Epiphania. He had two younger siblings named Theodore and Maria, who are possibly his half-siblings. His mother was of Cappadocian origin, and his father is rumored to have been of Armenian origin. Not much is known about his childhood, except that his father was an important general under Emperor Maurice, who fought against Bahram Shoban, a usurper of the Sasanian Empire in 590, and was later appointed to the position of Exarch of Africa. In 602, Emperor Maurice was killed along with his wife and children by a centurion named Phocas, who later was crowned the emperor. 6 years after his accession in 608, Heraclius the Elder renounced his loyalty and, along with his son Heraclius the Younger, began and led a rebellion known as the Heraclian Revolt. Although we have no evidence on what was the actual cause for the rebellion, it's most commonly thought that it's due to the terror and corruption spread throughout the reign of Phocas, avenging the death of Emperor Maurice or personal ambitions of the Heracli family. Heraclius the Elder, along with the rebels, produced coins portraying both Heraclius the Elder and the Younger as Hypatos, which was a Byzantine court dignity but did not claim the imperial title yet. An invasion of Egypt and Cyrenaica was led by Nicatos, who was the cousin of Heraclius the Younger, and by the year 609, he successfully defeated Bonosus, the general of Emperor Phocas, and secured the province for the rebels. And during that time, Heraclius the Younger sailed with another army force and launched a naval assault from North Africa against Constantinople through Sicily and Cyprus. Support for the rebellion came from most of Egypt and the Mediterranean. As the rebels closed in on Constantinople, both Heracli planned an attack to overthrow aristocrats in the city, but as he approached the capital, the elite imperial guard known as the Excubitors were led by Phocas, who was Phocas's son-in-law, abandoned Phocas to Heraclius, and he entered the city without much resistance. Finally, after capturing the Emperor Phocas, Heraclius the Younger asked him, "Is this how you have ruled, wretch?" Phocas replied, "And will you rule better?" To which Heraclius responded angrily by beheading Phocas on the spot. In October 5th, 610, Heraclius rose to the imperial throne and was crowned in the chapel of Saint Stephen within the great palace of Constantinople. His father was very happy about his ascension, but he would soon die shortly after the same year. On the same day of his accession to the imperial throne, Heraclius was wed to Fabia, who would later adopt the name Eudoxia in 610, and would give birth to Heraclius's only daughter named Eudoxia Epiphania. In 611, Heraclius's first son named Heraclius Constantine, the future emperor Constantine III in 612. The same year Heraclius Constantine was born, Eudoxia died after a few months due to epilepsy. Heraclius would go on to marry his niece through his sister Maria in 613, and it was very unpopular and considered unlawful. Martina would go on to be hated throughout Constantinople, and attempts to dissolve the marriage were made by the patriarch Serigius, but it proved unfruitful as Heraclius refused and would go on later to take her on campaigns with him. In 626, Martina would give birth to the future emperor Heraclius II, most commonly known as Heraclonas, and in 630 she had the future emperor David Tiberius, and in an unknown date Martinus, Heraclius's last child, would be born. Despite Emperor Maurice helping King Khosrau II to be restored back to the Sasanian throne and remaining allies until Maurice's death, Khosrau seized the opportunity to attack the Byzantine Empire and reconquer lost Sasanian territory in Mesopotamia. In his court, Khosrow had a man who claimed that he was allegedly Theodosius, the son of Maurice, and went to the Byzantines demanding to accept that alleged Theodosius as their emperor. Since Phocas's brutal mutiny and the later succession crisis, including the Heraclian revolt, it led the war to be in the Persians' favor for over a decade, in which they were able to capture Mesopotamia and Caucasus, and later would go on to enter Antioch through Syria in 611. As a response to this attack was given 2 years later by Heraclius, who would go on to suffer a defeat outside of Antioch by the Persian generals Shahrbaraz and Shahin. From then, the Persians would devastate Asia Minor and would go on to capture Chalcedon on the Bosphorus across from Constantinople. Palestine and Egypt would go on to be fully in Persian control by 621. And to add more damage, they would attack and heavily devastate Anatolia. Because of the commotion, the Avars and the Slavs would take opportunity and would overrun the Balkans, which greatly damaged the Byzantine Empire and causing it to be on the brink of destruction. By 613, with help from the Jewish revolt against Heraclius, the Persians conquered Damascus and in 614 conquered Jerusalem and along with it damaged the Church of the Holy Sepulchre as well as capture the allegedly true cross, which had been restored by Saint Helena, mother of Emperor Constantine the Great, years before. And to add more devastation for the Byzantines, they would capture Egypt in either 617 or 618. Due to the massive destruction and losses the Byzantines took, the final straw for Heraclius was when the Persians arrived at Chalcedon in 615, and he was ready to step down and make Byzantium a client state to be run by the Persians, and going as far as allowing Khosrow to choose the new emperor. In a peace letter sent by Heraclius to Khosrow, he acknowledged the fact that the Persians were far superior and described himself as Khosrow's obedient son, one who is eager to perform the services of your serenity in all things, as well as calling Khosrow the supreme emperor. Despite Heraclius's best effort to reach a peace deal with the Persians, Khosrow rejected the offer and would arrest the ambassadors which Heraclius sent. With the Persians waiting on word to continue the assault at the gates of Constantinople, the thought of fleeing the city and moving to Carthage passed on to Heraclius, but with encouragement from the powerful patriarch Seregius, he stayed behind the walls of Constantinople. Heraclius was finally able to reach a peace agreement with the Persians in exchange for an annual tribute of 1,000 tons of gold and silver, 1,000 silken robes, and last but not least, 1,000 horses to King Khosrow. After finally achieving peace, Heraclius was able to rebuild the empire by devaluing the currency and melting it down, as well as crossing out non-military related expeditions, all with the backing of Patriarch Seregius, whose church treasures is raised to fund the counterattack and continue the war. On April 4th, 622, leaving the city in the hands of Patriarch Seregius and General Bonus as well as regent of his sons, Heraclius left Constantinople and gathered his forces in Asia Minor, most probably in Bithynia. His army, who have lost hope after the crushing defeat at the hands of the Persians, seeing their emperor leading them to reconquer lost territories and restore the empire, greatly boosted their morale. In order to make his army see the worth of the counterattack, he made it take on the character of a holy war, carrying an Ikaropoietes as a military flag. The Roman army proceeded to Armenia first, defeating a Persian army led by an Arab chief who was an ally to the Persians. With the first victory at hand, the Roman army then went on to defeat the general Shahrbaraz, avenging the defeat they suffered outside of Antioch. Heraclius would stay on campaign for more years. In Caucasus, he won multiple battles in Armenia against the Persian generals Shahrbaraz, Shahan, and Shahraplakan. While Heraclius was busy with the Persians, the Visigoths were capturing Cartagena, which at the time was the capital of the province of Spania. In 626, the Avars and Slavs, supported and led by the Persian general Shahrbaraz, tried to besiege Constantinople, one of the many attempts to besiege the city, but the siege was unsuccessful and ended in devastating failure as the walls of Constantinople were very hard to destroy. But the Byzantines said that the victory was allegedly attributed to the religious icons in which Seregius ordered that they be hung around the walls of the city, and Heraclius's younger brother Theodore led another Byzantine army to victory against a Persian army led by Shahan. Taking advantage of the division within the Sasanian Empire, he was able to drift the Gok Turks of the Western Turkic Khaganate under the command of Tongyabro Karan to his side, likely because they have already invaded Persian Transcaucasia, and was able to make the general Shahrbaraz neutral in the conflict by telling him that Khosrow ordered his execution because of the king growing jealousy towards his general. In winter 627, Heraclius entered Mesopotamia, where he defeated the Persian led by Rahzahad at the Battle of Nineveh, despite the desertion of his Turkish allies. He went on along the Tigris and sacked the great palace at Dastagrid, and the only reason Heraclius didn't continue to Ctesiphon was because the bridges on the Nahrawan Canal were destroyed. Because of the disasters the Persian faced, Khosrow was deposed and killed by his son, the future king Khawad II, in a coup. Due to the severity of the situation, Khawad immediately sued for peace and sent the True Cross along with a negotiator, which ended in a deal in which the Persians would withdraw from the occupied territories which were ruled by the Byzantines and then taken by the Persians. In 629, Heraclius would assume the ancient Persian title, the King of Kings, and would later on assume the Greek title for kings, Basileus, which would later be used for the Byzantine emperors in the next 800 years. In the same year, he restored the True Cross to Jerusalem in a famous, massive, and majestic ceremony in which Heraclius himself carried the cross into the gates of Jerusalem. In an unspecified year, the Muslims and the non-believers of the tribe of Quraysh had a peace treaty called the Treaty of Hudaybiyah. After the treaty was set, the Prophet, peace be upon him, sent letters through the Sahaba radiallahu anhum to different kings in many regions to invite them and their people to Islam. The most famous trio being Khosrow II, king of the Sasanians, Armah, king of Oxum, most commonly known as An-Najashi, and last but not least, Heraclius I, emperor of the Romans. Through the Sahabi, Dihya al-Kalbi, the letter was given to the governor of Bushra in Syria, who later delivers it to Heraclius. Heraclius at the time was in Jerusalem, in which he was celebrating the restoring of the True Cross, as well as the victory over the Persians. When he received the letter, he was curious and wanted to know more about this man who claimed to be a prophet sent through God. Upon hearing that there was a caravan of Arab traders in the area, Heraclius ordered for them to be brought to him. The head of the trading caravan was Abu Sufyan, who at the time was a non-believer and opposed the Prophet, was approached by Roman soldiers who told him and his caravan to come see the Emperor Heraclius. Abu Sufyan, after becoming a Muslim, would tell the Sahabi Abdullah ibn Abbas about his meeting with the Emperor Heraclius about the letter from the Prophet. Abu Sufyan said that Heraclius sent a soldier to him while he was with his trading caravan doing business in the Levant, Palestine, which at the time he had a treaty with the Prophet. Abu Sufyan and his companions would later enter Heraclius' court in Jerusalem, in which all the senior Roman dignitaries were around him. Heraclius called for a translator who translated the whole conversation. The interaction went as Abu Sufyan narrated the story to Abdullah ibn Abbas.
هذا الرجل الذي ظهر فيكم يزعم أنه نبي. أيكم أقرب إليه نسبا؟
أنا أقربهم نسبا.
أدنو وليقف أصحابك عند ظهرك. إني سائل عن هذا الرجل فإن كذبني صاحبكم فكذبوه كيف نسبه فيكم؟
هو فينا ذو نسب
فهل قال هذا القول منكم أحد قط قبله؟
لا
فهل كان من آبائه من ملك؟
لا
فأشراف الناس يتبعونه أم ضعفاؤهم؟
بل ضعفاؤهم أكثر
أيزيدون أم ينقصون؟
بل يزيدون
فهل يرتد أحد منهم سخطة لدينه بعد أن يدخل فيه؟
لا لا
فهل كنتم تتهمونه بالكذب قبل أن يقول ما قال؟
لا
فهل يغدر؟
لا ونحن منه الآن في مدة من الصلح ولسنا ندري ما هو فاعل فيها
هل قاتلتموه؟
نعم.
فكيف كان قتالكم إياه؟
الحرب بيننا وبينه سجال، ينال منا وننال منه.
ماذا يأمركم؟
يقول: اعبدوا إلها واحدا ولا تشركوا به شيئا واتركوا ما يقوله آباؤكم. ويأمرنا بالصلاة والزكاة.
ذكرت أنه ذو نسب، فكذلك الرسل تبعث في نسب قومها، وأنه لم يقل قوله أحد قط قبله. فلو كان ذلك لقلت رجل يأتي بقول قيل قبله وليس من آبائه ملك، فلو كان لقلت رجل يطلب ملك أبيه. وما كنتم تتهمونه بالكذب قبل أن يقول ما قال، فقد أعرف أنه لم يكن ليذر الكذب على الناس ويكذب على الله. وأكثر من اتبعه الضعفاء وهم أتابع الرسل، وأصحابه يزيدون ولا ينقصون، وكذلك أمر الإيمان حتى يتم. ولا يرتد أحد سخطة لدينه بعد أن يدخل فيه، وكذلك أمر الإيمان حين تخالط بشاشته القلوب ولا يغدر، وكذلك الرسل لا تغدر. وسألتك بما يأمركم، فذكرت أنه يأمركم أن تعبدوا الله ولا تشركوا به شيئا، وينهاكم عن عبادة الأوثان. فإن كان كما تقول حقا، فسيملك موضع قدمي هاتين. هذا كتابه، اقرأه مرة أخرى على مسمع هؤلاء.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. من محمد رسول الله إلى هرقل عظيم الروم، سلام على من اتبع الهدى. أما بعد، فإني أدعوك بدعاية الإسلام. أسلم تسلم، يؤتك الله أجرك مرتين. فإن توليت فعليك إثم الآرسيين.
In his letter to Heraclius, the Prophet, peace be upon him, quoted verse number 64 of Surah number 3, Ali Imran. Say, O Prophet, O people of the book, let us come to common terms that we will worship none but Allah, associate none with him, nor take one another as lords instead of Allah. But if they turn away, then say, bear witness that we have submitted to Allah alone. In Muslim tradition, Heraclius is viewed as a just ruler. Scholar Ibn Kathir would go as far as to say that Heraclius was one of the wisest men and among the most resolute, shrewd, deep opinionated of kings. He ruled the Romans with great leadership and splendor. Islamic historians say that Heraclius was very impressed with the letter, that he would place it on his lap, and that he had sent the prophet robes and coinage. And then Heraclius wrote to an unnamed religious official in Rome. After receiving a response, he called the Roman assembly and said, if you desire salvation and the orthodox way so that your empire remains firmly established, then follow this prophet. The council rejected heavily, so he later decided against the conversion of the ruling class, but still sent an envoy to the prophet with praise from the emperor. Tradition holds it that Heraclius was bound to have accepted Islam, as he was 5 years younger than the prophet, and he dies 5 years after the prophet passed away, as well as the fact that unlike Khosrow, who approached the matter unreasonably, immediately tore up the letter as well as killed the ambassador. He exclaimed, a pitiful slave among my subjects dares to write his name before mine. But Heraclius, on the other hand, approached the matter reasonably. He viewed the letter justly, gathering witnesses to find out the truth. The prophet, after hearing responses from both rulers, said about Khosrow, may God tear apart his kingdom, and said about Heraclius, may God preserve his kingdom, which is evidence to Khosrow's death and his empire immediately being unstable and later fall, and Heraclius, whose empire thrived for another 800 years. It is possible that he accepted Islam in secret with fear of rebellion from his people. It is still a great mystery. However, in Muslim tradition, no one can deny the fairness and greatness of Emperor Heraclius. By 630, the emerging power known as the Rashidun Khalifa was starting to expand under the second Khalif and Sahabi, Umar ibn al-Khattab, the Arabs had finally unified all of the tribes of the Hijaz, which was way too divided to stand a chance, let alone be a threat to either the Byzantines or the Persians. After that, they started one of the most powerful states in the region at the time. In September of 629, the first ever conflict between the Arabs and the Byzantines was met at the Battle of Muttah, led by the Sahabi Zayd ibn Haritha and Byzantine general, as well as brother of Heraclius, Theodore. It was in response to the death of an Arab ambassador at the hands of the Ghassanid Roman governor, who was on his way to the ruler of Bushra. Zayd ibn Haritha, along with two of his commanders, Ja'far ibn Abi Talib and Abdullah ibn Rawaha, were slain in the battle. Thabit ibn Aqram would carry up the banner and save the remaining Muslim forces and lead them to battle. After that, Ibn Aqram would give the banner to Khalid ibn al-Walid to take the lead and continue the fight. With the result being a Byzantine victory, the Byzantines thought that there was no reason to make any military organization, as both sides had no experience of fighting each other in a war. Despite everything, the religious commitment of the Arab army, which despite being in development following the rise of Islam and the Rashidun, later was credited with the contribution to the Arabs' success against the Byzantines. The following year, the Arabs would launch a counterattack into Arabah to the Lake Tiberias. Successfully conquering Al-Karak, the Arabs would continue on into Negev and reach Gaza. In 636, at the Battle of Yarmouk, the Arabs led by Khalid ibn al-Walid resulted in a heavy and devastating defeat for the Byzantines, as well as taking Syria into Arab hands, in which, after hearing about the loss of Syria, Heraclius would famously say, farewell, a long farewell to Syria, my province, thwart an enemies now. Peace be with you, O Syria. What a beautiful land will you be for the enemy's hands. Within 3 years, the Levant would have been lost again, and after Heraclius' death of illness in 11 February 641, most of Egypt would be fallen to the Arabs as well. Many of his accomplishments include the reforms he made, which eliminated most of the corruption from the reign of Phocas, recovering the lost territories of the empire from Persia, recovery of the allegedly true cross back to Jerusalem, reforms and reorganizations of the military and economy, and, despite losing a lot of key territories to the Arabs, he was able to hold on to Carthage, which gave the empire a chance to be rebuilt. His most famous accomplishment was changing the official language of the empire from Latin to Greek, which would continue to be used until the fall of the empire. Although his territorial gains from the wars with Persia were in the end lost to the Arabs, he is still a top-ranking Eastern Roman emperor. He inherited a broken empire and was still able to restore it and give it 800 years more to live. That alone shows how great of a man and how great of an emperor Heraclius really was.